Good evening. I want to welcome everyone here tonight to our December Benedictine conversation. We're very happy to welcome you here. Tonight's Benedictine conversation is entitled Creating a Monastic Heart, the Search for What Matters in Life. I want to introduce my co-host here tonight, Sister Lois Eckes, and I'm Dawn Carrillo. I'm the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of St. Scholastica here in Duluth, Minnesota. We're so excited to welcome people from all over the country here this evening. And before I introduce our special guest, I want to start with a little prayer that is called Prayer of Those Who Dwell in a Monastery of the Heart. And it's written by our guest this evening, Sister Joan Chittister. And so we pray. Loving God, you who dwell in our hearts, make for us a cave there in which to hear your voice more distinctly, feel your care more tenderly, understand your will more clearly, and come to know your presence at every moment of our lives with new clarity and new courage, with new faith and new urgency. Enable us to grow in the Benedictine spirit in ways that make us compassionate co-creators of a world in process. Creative keepers of the human community, loving listeners to the heartbeat of the world, caring sisters and brothers to its wounded, and bringers of peace to a world in distress. Let us sink into your word. Let us nourish it to life. Let it lead us beyond the burdens of the day so that we may become the people you desire us to be. Give us hearts where all may enter in, ears to hear your call, hands to do your will, voices to sing your praise, and soul enough to recognize you in everything we do. This we ask through the intercession of all the faithful monastics who have gone before us, and through the grace of the living God. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
What a beautiful way to start this evening. As we go through the conversation tonight, you are invited. All of you who are participants are invited to send in any comments or questions by chat. I'll be watching the chat. And so I want to introduce our guest this evening. Our guest is Sister Joan Chittister from her community in Erie, Pennsylvania. She comes to us. Sister Joan has captured the hearts, and more importantly, the imagination of people all over the world and from many different faith traditions. On fire with the rule of Benedict and through her passion for truth, justice, and peace, her writings, her interviews, her speaking, and all that she is show us a way, a Benedictine way, to become a wiser and gentler people. I, as many of us here tonight, follow in the wake of Joan's inspiration, renewed in hope and conviction that we can live into the fulfillment of God's dream for us. And so we welcome you here tonight with us, Sister Joan. Thank you so much for being here.
I'm the lucky one, Dawn. I'm the lucky one, and I know it. I know that that our centers that are opening everywhere are seeding the future out of land that has been dealt with harshly in this country and in this world. So what you're doing is building a new Benedictinism, making us a new spiritual life, and it must never be either undermined or underrated. You are the Benedictine monasteries that will bring the future into fullness. We're in transmission now. We're in transition and transmission, and we have to understand that. We aren't here to claim where we are. We're here to take what we got and plant it in a way that can speak to this generation best. So,
Beautiful. Thank you. And I know that Sister Lois had wanted to say a couple of things before we begin here. So,
oh, that's all right. I'd really rather listen to Joan. But maybe just to say, Joan, that you've been one of my most influential mentors for a long time in my life. And I really treasure the heart connection that we share.
And so, we do. And yeah. We do. And you know it, Lois, because it starts back in Duluth, right, in the 80s, where my reverence for your community has stuck forever. I hear the word Duluth, my ears come up, my eyes open, and I say, good stuff. It's from that place.
Oh, that's beautiful. Thank you.
That is real. Real as it can be.
And we feel that. Thank you so much.
You're right. You're right. Okay. I know.
Yes.
We went through a lot together, Lois.
We
and it was all worth it.
It was. It was God's grace at work in all of us, right? The miracle. Yes. Could you tell us a little bit about the unfolding of your own story? And how did you move from the life that into which you were born to where you find yourself today?
Well, I'm going to give you some pieces. I stopped at that question. I said, my God, these people are going right to the center of this thing. They are amazing. So I said to myself, well, do you have an answer for them? Maybe. So I sat down and I took the pieces of this mosaic, which I've never done before, with a question like that, that said, how'd you take this and get this? I backed up. And so here's the map. My father died at the age of 25. I was just a little short of 3. And my mother was 23. And it's in the middle of a depression, or the depression itself is crumbling. On top of that, I was an only child. My mother had lost a baby in the process, lost her father, and lost her husband within months of one another. So this is you would expect a fragile little woman, wouldn't you? She married again, and she married what the church called a mixed marriage, which I think is the first part of the answer to your question. As a baby, literally as a baby, I somehow or other figured out that this one life that we had was now two. It was two separate ways. But that's why the church called it a mixed marriage. And the question was, could a Catholic and a Protestant, under any circumstance, first of all, the church said they shouldn't be married. And then when it figured out that they would get married, then the church is on a very sharp edge up here on the mountain, trying, it seems, to take this mixed marriage and keep it separate. It was nonsense, but it was part of the theological anthropology of the time. But my mother, in making this step, somehow or other communicated to me that I had to learn to sift and to choose and to make up my mind between unlike positions. Now, most Catholic families, you didn't have to do that. The children all got taught the same thing. Father and mother said the same thing. Father at the church said the same thing. I never lived in that. I'm three, and then I'm four, and then I'm five. And every year it gets more difficult. They get more difficult. The religion is more of a burden for both of them. And I am in the middle of this. Everybody's assuming that I get the Catholic picture, but I got a lot of the Protestant picture too. And I found strong, good people there. So now I'm really confused, right? I'm 5 years old and I don't know who's good and who isn't. But then I get to be six and I figure out that it's really not a problem. Just don't tell them that you know it. That's all. Just ignore this thing. In the middle of this, I have a very strong young mother who there was a sentence that she said over and over again as I grew. And it was, you have to be able to take care of yourself, John. You have to be able to take care of yourself. If anything happens to me, if anything happens to your father, you have got to be able to take care of yourself. Now that's a high level. That's high level entree, friends. I mean, that's saying to a child, you're on your own, kid. There won't be anybody else. Mm. So you must be prepared. Now, you can also never expect anyone else to get you through. Now, your question was very precisely and very well put. It was your question that really unearthed in me the driving power of that statement that the baby heard. You have to be able to take care of yourself, Joan. There is no one else. When the educational system came along, and I was about five and a half, I guess, they were experimenting, and there are people my age who will remember that one of the big educational experimentations of the time was identifying kids who could skip a grade. Now, I don't remember what they expected to have come from that socially, but when they came to my house with this proposition that I wouldn't have to go to first grade and I could maybe start right at second and maybe even third after I got this test, my mother said, absolutely not. Oh, no, you don't. I don't want her to skip any grades whatsoever. I was sitting on the floor listening to this conversation, and I remember them trying to tell her that it would be so much better because I'd get into high school earlier, and I could have special courses, and I would be out of school faster. My mother said, I don't want her out of school faster. I want her to grow according to her age. Mm-hmm. I know what she's like intellectually. I know that. You can't tell me that. I live with this kid and I know the problems. She said, but I am not going to allow her to be put in a class that is socially older. Now, where did she get that? Mm-hmm. I have no answer for that. We would have called that now a psychological reason. You barely had the discipline of psychology at that time. Nobody was reading it or anything like it. So, but when I look back into your question, I said to myself, she did right. I was now a little older. My birthday's in April. So I was now a little older than other first graders, which you see made me almost a natural leader. Everything that I learned was for me. Everything that was told to me. And then when I get into a grade school classroom, I'm just a little bit older than every other child in the room. That if you don't remember, but I remember hearing that every time somebody said to my mother, Is Joan your only child? Yeah, Joan's our only child. And poor child. It was considered a terrible thing to have only an only child. So in fact, I can remember in first grade on the last day of school, sister gave out very important statues, Joseph and Mary and some guys I didn't know and some camels I liked and things like that. And my best friend, the woman who became my best friend, was also a very smart little kid. And she got the number one statue. She got the statue of Jesus, and I got the statue of Mary. Now that was clearly second class, and I knew it. I ran all the way home. My mother said, well, what's going on? And I said, I want a statue. I want a statue. My mother said, that's wonderful. I said, no, it isn't. She said, what do you mean it isn't? I said, it's second place, and nobody told me I was running for anything. it's a classic story. Nobody told her she was running for anything. And I was really disappointed that I had not been told that information, because I found it easy. I just kind of went through it. It was out of those moments, however, that the concept of strength and independence and purpose, they're all there. You found them all. Everything that drives me today drove me for that statue in second grade, I'll tell you. And every single thing put me on my own road. There has to be some meaning to that, some explanation from that, to now look at these various paths. With that mentality and a mother that strong and a situation that independent, I took one look at the Baden-Josephs and later the Erie Benedictines, and I saw the smartest, strongest, most effective women in the world. And at the age of 5, 9, 10, 15, I knew exactly where the powerful women were. It was clear to me. I didn't have the language, but I knew that nobody else even began to have that kind of certainty as those nuns did. Sit down, be quiet, I'll tell you when to talk, and they meant it. And somehow or other, they weren't worried that any man was going to come in and tell them they couldn't do it. So here I was, alone, independent, very sociable kid, but I was not defined by any groups. I didn't cling to groups. I had a strong social life all my life, but I had no interest in joining crowds just to join crowds. So as a result, I spent my life playing my piano, reading my books, and plotting my own way through life with a mother who was teaching me how to do that. So I entered the monastery at 16, shocks people. It's amazing now, even to me, but then it was a very different time. You know, people look at me and they say, oh, I can't believe you did that. Why? My other best friends were getting married at the age of 18. They were pregnant at the age of 17. Nobody seemed surprised by that in terms of, was it good for a woman to do so? Our times, they cannot be compared because they rest on very different pillars. The whole, in that period, it was taken for granted that women were literally housewives, wived to the house, responsible for the house, responsible for him, responsible for the kids, but had almost no responsibility for their own lives once that marriage was set. And few girls, as a result, had any reasonable life aspirations of any kind. So I entered the monastery. It fit. It just always fit. And I found myself, as the years went by, I kept winding up in the center of things, in the center of the faculty, in the center of the teaching world, in the center of religious life in its renewal days in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, which were really hard days for women religious, in the center of peace and justice programs around the world, and in all of them, just naturally fearless. You have to be able to take care of yourself, Joan. So I didn't lie around crying or whimpering or wringing my hands. This would be too hard for me. What are you talking about? Nothing is too hard for you. You just get out there and do it. So I had not grown up with anyone telling me that I couldn't do anything that I wanted to do. And I put this down, I made notes before you and I met. And I said, are you really gonna tell that kind of truth? I said, yeah, they're right. This is how I get into trouble. But it is truth. It's clear truth. And truth became my brand. The Jesus story is my story. It was the spiritual life, not specific spiritual practices at all, that became the shaping of both my heart and my soul. And anything outside of that would have been a living lie. So that's the deepest answer I have ever given anybody who asked a question like that. I've always just swept by it. But I understood in your question that somebody there intuited the fact that this was not a normal childhood. There was just something wrong here. And how did it happen? Where did it come from? I think I came pretty close. The sifting of ideas when you're 3 and 4 and 5 years old and knowing that there are distinctions and sometimes very harsh ones, that you know, you have no cousins, no aunts, no uncles, no grandparents, nothing. You stand alone in the world and you better be able to handle it. Those are great lessons. They didn't hurt me. And they may come pretty close to really answering your question, I hope, because I meant it to be right. Life is nothing but a series of possibilities. You choose A or you choose B all the way along the life. And so I chose under the ideas I could understand, under the things that I felt I could do, the ways I thought I could help, the work I thought should be continued. And actually, it's not much different today at the age of 86 than it was at the age of 3.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Joan. That was awesome. Thank you.
That was just beautiful. And I do have to say, I told you before we began tonight that we have had this wonderful book group, a book discussion group that has been using your book. The book that's your most recent book, I believe. The Monastic Heart, 50 Simple Practices for a Contemplative and Fulfilling Life. So that question actually came out of one of their discussions.
Yes, it did. Yes, it is.
I want to ask you about the book. I'm curious what particularly prompted you to write this book. And a lot of people might have a question about what does it mean to create a monastery within myself?
Lovely question. Beautiful question. Well, I saw this one and I smiled too. I smiled. I tell these people these truths. Well, it's just, they're strange. Okay, here's the story about the book. It starts at a luncheon 50 years ago. And my very special friend, who, as I tell this story tonight, is dying, and very, very hard on me and on all of us as a community during these days, because she was a wise and prescient woman. You know, Joan understands these things, or Lois understands them. I mean, there are just certain people in every religious community who get where they're going slightly differently. And everybody in the community knows that there is some sort of a precious insight here. Now, this woman is a poet, a published poet. She does not write either essays or fiction, but she and I, for obvious reasons, have been simply connected for years. So we're at lunch, and 50 years ago, and she says, "You know, you have to write another book on monasticism." I said, "Oh, come now. I think I've written myself out. I'm not ready to do anything else again." She said, No, I know you're wrong. You haven't even begun to write," she said, "but you certainly haven't written." She said, "You know, John, we sit around and we talk all these things about the monastery and spirituality and the coming together of groups and everybody looking for a spiritual life. And we tell them all about 1500 years and the 6th century saint, and they don't understand a word. You know, we've got our own vocabulary, and we use it. We sit down with people, we talk about lectio and the chapter and the wonderful moment of the vows. And they're very polite. They all just look at us, but nobody understands anything." And I said, "Oh, Mary Lou, I'm not, what are you talking about?" I said, I'm not going to write a Benedictine glossary. For heaven's sakes, I've got more interest." "No," she said, I think it's more important than you realize it. And you're the one to do it. I want you to do it." So she said, "Here, I have a piece of paper. You take this piece of paper. Now, let's write down 25 things, 25 words that people probably don't have a clue about in Benedictine history." So we wrote down 25 things. She went to the ladies' room. When she went to the ladies' room, I folded up the paper. I put it in my pocket. I said goodbye to her. I had to go. I walked out of the little dinette, and I said to myself, "Well, that's over. I got it out of her skin, honest. Imagine I'm going to sit down there and write about 25 words. She's out of her mind." 25 years went by, another. And it was lunch 25 years ago, and we met at the same little diner. And out of the blue, this woman says to me, "You haven't written that book yet." I said, "You don't remember." She said, "I've been waiting for it. I've waited for it for 25 years. She said, "You have to write this book." I said, "25 terms won't do it, Mary Lou. It's nothing but a cartoon. What do they call them when the kids read them? They're just these little cartoon things." So
comics.
She said 25 isn't, you're right. She said, "It's not enough." She said, "That doesn't tell them the whole life. Here's a piece of paper. I have a piece of paper. We'll do 25 more words." So I walk out at lunch that day, and I now have a book of 50 monastic terms that I'm supposed, she said, "We need that by Christmas, you know, so you better start it today, start the book today, and just go away and write for a while, it'll be fine." When the book was finished, I sent it away. A publisher had said, "Joan, what are you working on?" I said, "Well, I'll tell you, but you're going to think I'm out of my tree." So I told the guy, I said, What are you talking about? That sounds like a very good idea to me. I couldn't possibly define any of these things. I just happen to know that they're good. And I think people would love to hear that. So I go home with this thing and I say to myself, okay, Joan, your problem here is to help people see another kind of spiritual life than the rules and the canons and the customs and the practices of the church, beautiful and meaningful as they were, but long gone now, that there's a deeper way into the spiritual life. There's a more personal way into the life of the hermit within us, if we just tell people what it is. So, dear friends, that's how we got here tonight. That's where that book is from. It says, let me tell you how you can step into your own spiritual life. And you don't have to go to a monastery to do it. The monastic life is a beautiful communal life. You may already be in a beautiful life, but saying to yourself, with so many changes in the church, I don't even know what I'm in at all anymore. I don't know what it means. I don't know why they do it. I don't know why they don't do it anymore. We used to do all these things. Now we don't do any of those. But I think, Lois, that I could say very honestly that if someone like you two would allow people to discuss this themselves together, and to apply these very, who would know that they're practices? Lois, you know that. You know that. It's, they don't, when I was a kid, the practice was after compline night to hold your hands out for 3 minutes and see if you could survive that. It was it was supposed to be your physical asceticism or something for the day. Nobody knew what it was about, really. And when we began to stop the extraneous stuff, that was the first, that came right out of French spirituality in the 16th and 17th century. It had nothing to do with Benedictine spirituality. It was just that all religious did those things. So suddenly I got into writing this text, a word at a time, and I fell in love more and more and more with our own lifestyle, with what it was to be a Benedictine straight from the 6th century up to the 21st and 22nd century, and saying to yourself, this is good for the soul.
Oh, you know, Joan, I'm just in awe of how the Holy Spirit persisted through your dear friend Mary Lou to get you to do this, because I must tell you, this book group that has been reading your book has just exactly loved just how you described how it would speak to the heart. Is there a favorite chapter or two, or if people are feeling overwhelmed by life or whatever, is there a place where you would, because as you know, as we, if we haven't read the book, you can start anywhere in the book.
Yeah, and I did. Believe it or not, and I'm not kidding, what I have here are like those first 10 or 12 or 15 chapters. They're there because they're so sweet. They take life and grass and antiphons and the time that you get to chapel in Statio, and it's all part, these are all the parts of your life too. You don't call them that, and you don't hear a bell ring and stop and say, I'm not here talking to these wonderful people for nothing. I'm here because talking about God is more important in my life for their life than if I never told them at all. So little by little, this book opens up the sense of the spiritual within you, within you. It doesn't come out in rules. It doesn't come out in signs. I just put my finger into the center of your soul and say, there it is. There it is. You know, for the people, I always have such respect for Islam and also the Hindus, who all have these little altars inside their room, their house. Well, Benedict was telling us the same thing when he said, make an oratory and keep it separate from the rest of the house. So you, in your most fatigued moments, can go in, sit down, light a candle, let a little ether and a little bit of incense go by, and remember that what the old diary said, all the way to heaven is heaven. And remember that you've just taken another step in the heaven that is yours here to prepare you for the heaven that will be yours there. So all of our lives all go together in these same things, bells and involvement, being late for school, late for work, late for prayer. You're exhausted. You come sliding into first base. And the rule of Benedict says, no, wait a minute. In fact, I tell this story, I think, in a book about, I'm 16, I've just entered. The novice mistress has her first catechism lesson with us, I guess it was. And she says, now sisters, the Vespers bell rings at 5 o'clock. You are to be there at 5 to 5. Pardon me. The Vespers bell rings at 5 o'clock. So you are to be there at 5 to 5. Well, wait a minute. Could we back up a little bit? could you tell me, Sister Aurelia, is Vespers at 5 or at 5 to 5? Which one? She said, Vespers begins at 5, and you are to be in your pew at 5 to 5. Why? I have 5 whole minutes to get there. Why am I getting there 5 minutes earlier? So that you know why you're there. So that you are ready to pray. So that you can put down all the stories of the day, all the sweating you did out in the field, all the trouble you had in that classroom. And how many times in your job, you come flying in at 1 minute to 5. You say, oh my God, I thought I was going to really be late. No, I'm all right. I'll just hang up my coat and I'll be right in. It's become a mantra in the United States of America. Everybody's late. Everybody's sliding in. Nobody is coming in, sitting down, putting their hands between their knees and saying, oh, in a minute. Psalm 119. I love Psalm 119. It's really important for me. I have to remember that. It's that statio that we stop and we tell ourselves what we're doing and where we go to do it and why we're doing it and what good it's doing in us. So when you walk into a chapel, in a woman's community, you will find they're all there early. You say, wow, why'd they come? I thought it was at 5. It is at 5. That's why they came at 5 to 5. That's to make sure that the heart gets to Vespers too. So statio is a really important part of life, and all of us are exhausted by it. And the mothers are running home to start supper. You know, the fathers forgot the bag at work and can't get the work done at night, and so mutters all night long. Nothing going on other than that. And so when you look at these early chapters, they're really all about your life. Some of the other ones, as it gets older, you won't recognize, but you'll learn a lot from. And you'd say to yourself, maybe, gosh, yeah, I could go sit by myself for 10 minutes a day. I'd love it. I'd feel so guilty sitting down for 10 minutes and just saying, the Holy Spirit is here. The breath of God is in me here. My house and my family and my husband and my kids. I can see all their faces. I love them so much. I know they're all from God, and we are a godly family. I got to tell him he has to get home 10 minutes earlier every day. And we'll both sit down together, and we'll feel better. And we'll get the kids to sit down and take a deep breath too. It's all there. It's the way we live the day. And this whole book is about the way you and I live each of the parts of every day. And if you don't have to do them all, there's no reason to do them all. You just simply do what you need, and you'll find yourself going back to it more and more often at all times. So here's this, when a bell rings, I remember why I'm doing what I'm doing. What is good about this thing? You know, after you make so many peanut butter and jelly sandwiches, somebody has to tell you why making peanut butter and jelly sandwiches is such a holy thing for you. And you say, Well, what I did was I came down here at the soup kitchen and I volunteered my time. And I come every Wednesday, and Wednesday is peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. Now, is that a noble spiritual act? Yes, it is, honey. Yes, it is. It is your act of creation for those who can't do it themselves that day.
You know, Joan, you're touching on something that is so important, I think, for us to think about today. It's kind of absent. You talked a little bit about how we rush from one thing to another. In the intro of this book, you say that monasticism is the single-hearted search for what matters in life. So can you tell us tonight, what is it that really matters in life?
What matters in life is returning to creation, what the Creator gave us to develop. That's all it is. And that means then that I must understand creation as the presence of God in my life at all times. That's how I do it. And then it is this sense of rightness. You know, it's only peanut butter and jelly, but that's what they need. And it's right that they get it right now, that they get it this way from these people. When we have this book club, that's the most important thing in life, because it is seeding that soul. You don't know what's going to happen at that book club that night, but you'll get a letter someday from somebody who says, Don, I was in your book club I don't remember who wrote the book, and I don't really know where it's from, but it was something about Benedictine words. And at first, I just thought it was so silly. And then I began to remember the words, and I read the book, and I discovered they're all in me, Dawn. Mm. They're all in me. But because this comes from the 6th century, how was I supposed to know that it was still there still there, the rain of it coming down in the 20th century and the 21st century, and my life and my family and my relationships and my job and my sense of rightness. That's the most important thing in life. It is connecting creation with the presence of the Creator in you.
Wonderful. Beautiful. You know, that leads me to ask you, Joan, because I feel you're really expanding this beautiful vision that led you to write this book, or that Mary Lou prompted you to write. What is your vision for the future of our global community?
Yeah, probably, Lois, exactly like yours. This is God's world. And if all of a sudden Genesis comes alive, here it is, here's everything I've given you, everything you need to live in this universe, I have already given. The grass and the apples and the animals and the buffalo and the elephants and the children and the rain and the snow and the sun and the emeralds and the minerals and the fire. It's all here. Everything any one of us ever needed to maintain this peace of creation, meaning this peace of the Creator, is here, and we are systematically ruining every single one. What is a great sin of humanity? It's the refusal to reclaim humanity and our responsibility for it. This is the greatest original sin.
Can you say that again? Can you repeat that?
Yeah. What we're doing is the greatest original sin that the church ever identified in what it meant to live beyond our own selfishness. This is immoral.
Mm-hmm.
This is a sin against the Creator, against creation. And we can't get people to sign a petition to clean up the oceans. Somebody will do it. Oh, heavens, they know what they're doing. They've already decided. They're just trying to scare us. That I don't know anything. I don't do anything about those things. Well, you do something about your grandchildren, honey, because you're killing them. And your children. What have you attached yourself to? What have you engaged in at all? Oh, yeah, you can drift with feeling holy words. But until you get them and live them, you haven't even begun. You're faking. You're faking.
So the reclaiming of our humanity, break that open for us. You said the greatest sin is not reclaiming our humanity.
And the second phrase, and our responsibility for it.
So in reclaiming our humanity, I imagine what you're talking about is what God has created us to be.
Exactly. What did Benedictines do in the 6th century? They cared for the world, for life. Rome had collapsed. The legions were gone because they had already drained all of the foreigners from any tax money that they could possibly pay. So the legions just went home. Nobody was paying them anymore. Nothing was being done. And so up here, the leadership had gone corrupt and dumb. And over here, the people who saw what was going on scooped down to take the land from A and the mountains from B and the water from C. We own this. We plugged it. This whole mountain is ours. Does it sound familiar? Because it's all around us. Mm-hmm. The people who own the land we're living on, but won't let the homeless live on it because it's their land. We're deeply in sin, deeply in sin. But we prefer to think that sin is what the first grade teacher taught us. We have not grown up spiritually. We think we have been teaching spirituality for 200 years. Certainly 100 in our own families. And it's all about these little ideas. You make the sign of the cross when you go in the church and everybody knows you're Catholic and how good you are. But the real Catholic goes into that church, prays for the strength to go down to the local director of streets, roads, and land, and says we have to create small little houses for the immigrants who are coming in. They're sleeping with their children on their chests in mud because they were starving to death where they came from. And they were told that if they followed the garbage cans of the world to the back door of the restaurants in the United States, they could feed their families.
You know, there's a comment that has come in. And one of the things I was just going to ask you about was what are the internal resources that we need to do what you're talking about? Because it's not happening. In the same way, we have a person who asked, what can we do to renew the church that is bleeding priests and members? So I think it touches on the same thing. What are the internal resources we need?
Well, it does. I'm gonna separate them though, so that we can get a more particularized awareness. Sure. In the first place, if obviously our political leadership, most of it, is not going to do this. They're going to sit there and pick up their pensions for the next three elections. That's what we're getting. And so, in the meanwhile, the Rhine is going dry. The Danube is going down. The Mississippi is having its own problems. We are watching the climate change our way of living, let alone planting or anything else. So what we have to understand is, I don't know where your heart lies. You do. What are you most interested in? Buffalo or elephant? Oceans or rivers? The homeless or your children? Because each of you has something stirring in here. When you see a beaten dog, you say, oh my God, thank God for the Annas that are picking up these animals and taking care of them. We are destroying the species on this earth. You're worried about little things like COVID? My honey, in five more years, if we don't begin to concentrate better, you will be right back under an African tree being eaten to death by little midges that you didn't even know existed. You have to find your interest and attach to it. Now, some of you will do it, 3 to 5 of you, to 50 of you, to 100 of you, to the city that you live in. Let's us be known as a city that is saving trees. It doesn't have to be big. It doesn't have to be dramatic. It doesn't have to be to take all the wealth you've ever managed to put in your pocket for your retirement. Nobody wants that. But somehow or other, the American mind has got to change. And American groups have to come together in order to say to the leadership, we're not there. If this isn't on your next electoral card, you will get none of us. That's all you understand, is getting the seat and the pension, getting the seat and the pension. Now, until the people themselves stand up, this isn't going to change. The pensions are still going to be ground out, and that seat's going to go to somebody else. And pretty soon, the people are going to see through those seats.
Mm. Joan, you know, can I just ask one question before we have to stop? I'm recognizing the time. Joan, you probably know that our series, our Benedictine Conversations series, this year has been on the theme of joy. And after all that you've just shared with us so movingly and powerfully, where is your hope? Where do you find joy? Would you be willing to?
Yeah, I can tell you that. And it's not difficult for me to say it. I find it in people like you, in people who bother to gather strangers together at 8 o'clock at night and say, what's your best hope spiritually? You see, it's all there. It's nothing you have to search for. It is in front of your faces. It's exactly what Jesus said. Look at what you've seen. What have you seen here? The hungry are fed. The sick are taken care of. He told you what these barriers are. He's told you what roads we have to go down. There's nothing unusual about what I'm saying. There is nothing complex about it. A first grade teacher could tell 30 little kids and they get it. Just like you and I got it in the first grade, 40, 50, 60 years ago. They showed you the pictures. These children of ours are seeing the pictures of the walruses dying on beaches, hundreds at a time. And they're looking up at the father and saying, Daddy, what will happen to walruses? Well, honey, we're going to run out of walruses. Will it make any difference? Well, I mean, I suppose that there's something. I suppose, do you suppose how much gas you need in your car? Do you suppose what electricity you're buying? They get out there and find out. And then you talk to the next person, and you talk to the next person, and you talk to the next person. And pretty soon, guess what? You've got a Catholic army of people who care about the ocean, because the Creator wants us to care. It's very simple.
The time has flown by, and it's time for us to close already, but I want to read a couple of comments that have come in. Adam says, there's so many things we can do to help our fellow man, but how can we help locally to really make an influence? I love your wisdom, Sister Joan. God bless.
And You ask your leadership what they're doing about it and tell them your group wants to join. And they say, we're supposed to, what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to put clear bottles here and brown bottles here. And we haven't quite done that yet. Then get it. In our block, we intend to recycle. And this city has to put up the cycling elements that we need to put our bottles in. It's so simple. It's pathetic. It'll bore you to death.
Marilyn says, your book has indeed changed many. I thank you for that. And I thank God for your mother who is still here through you. Thank you for listening to her. She was right. You really have and do inspire us, set us to doing. Thank you. Thank you. Bless you and your wisdom. We will keep reading and doing. You are right on.
Oh, God bless her. I know. It's one woman like that who can start an army of Catholics.
She was actually the facilitator for our book group. So she is wonderful. Yeah. And Kelly says, why should we stay Catholic? What advice do you give to young people who yearn for a spiritual life but don't find it in the church? Is it better to fight for justice outside of the church where more advocacy can exist?
Well, you know what, honey? Don't sink it down to better or worse. Just do it. Just do it. It doesn't make any difference. I mean, there'll be big gaping holes everywhere. Yes, I know that. Of course. Until it becomes normative. Then you know that's true. We have red lights. We didn't always have red lights in at the corners of Erie, Pennsylvania, but God help you if you don't obey red lights here now. All of this stuff is going to be normal if we just stand up and claim it and require that leadership provide the means of doing it. We have to. This is not funny. What am I so concerned about? I'll be lucky if I'm here 6 months from now, for God's sake. And I'm buying my ticket every day and I'm perfectly happy about it. But you're going to be here. Your children are going to be here for years. And the pictures you are seeing now of the people crossing the Rio Grande tonight is going to be the pictures of your children's children.
Powerful. Joan, you've been awesome.
Oh, yes.
Thank you so much. This has been just such a blessing. You are such a blessing. Oh, you are
true. You did promise me that you'd let me end with something. And I want to
do it. I did.
St. Augustine writes this: of the three theological virtues, faith, hope, and love, hope is greatest. Faith only tells us that God is. Love only tells us that God loves us. But hope tells us that God will work God's will. And we know that because God has two lovely daughters, anger and courage. Anger so that what should not happen cannot happen, and courage so that what must happen can happen. My prayer for you, for this book group, for your families, for your neighbors, for this generation, for this era, that you will all feel a touch of anger and a burst of courage and see it as the holiest thing God has ever given you. So,
thank you, Joan.
God bless you all.
God bless you.
God bless you. And thank you, everyone out there, for being with us here tonight. And I want to say, on behalf of the Sisters of St. Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, to everyone with us tonight, to you, Joan, and your community, we wish you and your loved ones a lovely Christmas holiday and a joy-filled new year.
You too. Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas to you. Thank you.
Merry Christmas.